The coefficient of friction is a dimensionless value dependent on the two materials that are in contact with one another. To find the coefficient of friction, one must first find the frictional force and the normal force. The normal force is equal to the gravitational force. One must assume that the frictional force is equal to the applied force. This is the case when the object is moving at a constant velocity. As you can see on the dry run, sand builds up in front of the brick. This creates an additional force that opposes the direction of motion. This simplified force diagram illustrates the force produced by the buildup of sand. The magnitude of this force is based off the soil properties as well as the depth of the sand buildup. Using basic geometry, we can solve the triangular distributed force to a single force acting one-third the height of the sand from the base of the brick. The magnitude of this force is controlled largely by the height of the sand buildup. This begs the question, why does the sand build up in the front of the brick in the first place? This diagram illustrates the forces acting on the brick. The normal force, gravitational force, and applied force all act through the brick's center of mass. The frictional force, however, acts across the base of the brick, a distance of y from the center of mass. This creates a negative or clockwise torque on the brick. As it moves forward, this torque forces the leading corner into the sand. Why does the torque only affect the dry soil? To explain this, one must look at the somewhat ugly equation for the ultimate net bearing capacity. The important term in this equation is the second gamma. Gamma denotes the bulk unit weight of the soil. This is proportional to the degree of saturation and the unit weight of water. Hence, adding some water can increase the bearing capacity. The graph results can be used to determine the coefficients of friction for the various methods of transportation. When solving using the average applied force, it appears that adding water increases the force needed to shift the brick for all methods bar the rollers. This, however, is most likely due to the short run length of the experiment. The buildup of sand in front of the transportation method only occurs towards the end of the run. This means the average applied force does not represent the effect of the sand buildup. When the maximum applied force is used to determine the coefficient of friction, it is clear that the water reduces these. It should also be noted that my arm does not have the precision of a machine. According to Newton's second law, if the brick's speed is not constant, that is to say it was accelerating, then the applied force must be equal to the frictional force as well as the force needed for acceleration. This would increase the values of the coefficients of friction. As wood would have been the primary material for the construction of the transportation devices, it is unlikely any will be found surviving in the archaeological record. Wood is easily recycled, and Egypt does not have a natural abundance of it. The most legitimate form of evidence for megalith transportation methods is depictions on tomb walls. Because of this, rollers can be ruled out as a possible method even though they are the most effective. This is due to the ease in which they could have been depicted but nevertheless were omitted.